Shreveport, Louisiana was the only place where my dad could get a job. I had a lot of emphasis on learning, created by my parents. I started to play flute because, though I wanted to play French horn, my sister was getting a new instrument, so my parents gave me the hand-me-down. I, in fact, was going to go into music until my senior year in high school when suddenly my dad passed away. He was a wonderful pediatrician. I babysat for her kids. She asked me on weekends to go do rounds with her at the charity hospital in Baton Rouge. It was Dr. Martha Pope's influence, I'm sure, that drove me in the direction of medicine. I then entered college in Baton Rouge with a double major, pre-med, music. It was the curiosity of science that really captured me. When I got accepted to medical school, I asked all of the surgeons if they liked being a general surgeon. To my great surprise, they said, "It's okay." It was really a mediocre, lukewarm response. When the people volunteered what they would do differently if they had another chance, they all said they'd go into ophthalmology, 100% of them. Surgery, OB, internal medicine, psychiatry, I did them all, but ophthalmology kept bubbling up. None of those places were taking women into residency programs that involved surgery. LSU band had won a contest, and we had played during college in the East-West Shrine Game as the prize. And I thought, wow, that's a pretty place. I sought out the programs next in San Francisco at Pacific Medical Center then. It's currently called California Pacific Medical Center. A Dr. Bruce Spivey responded to my letter and asked me to come out for an externship. And that's how I ended up in an ophthalmology residency in San Francisco. I got to do a lot because I was sort of the second fiddle in this small place. The most memorable teacher I had was Dr. Bill Spencer. Ocular pathology has a lot of giants from that era, and Bill Spencer was one of those. Who would I have rubbed up against for strabismus? None other than Art Jampolsky. And then there was another fellow there named Alan Scott, who was doing this strange chemo denervation stuff that ultimately was the Botox mania. I went to work with Bill Hoyt at the University of California, San Francisco, and he strongly suggested diverting to pediatric ophthalmology instead of neuro. So off to London I went to study with David Taylor at the Hospital for Sick Children, Great Ormond Street in London, England. Peds is the best, peds strabismus, and what I saw in London was a smorgasbord of tertiary, quaternary problems. There were other notable experiences in London as well. It's when infant cataract surgery first started, and there was a weekly infant aphakic contact lens clinic at Moorfields Eye Hospital. And that was just a revelation as well, that you could rehabilitate kids who were born with congenital cataracts. It was a fantastic experience. I came back to be a faculty member at CPMC. It's a wonderful privilege to be a pediatric ophthalmologist. It's a responsibility, sure, but where else, how else, can you play games all day long, help people out, be paid reasonably well, and just delight in the beauty of a kid, the innocence, the naivete, the humor, the different way of seeing the world. It's just fantastic. It was a struggle to build a practice back then, but I stayed busy doing other things. And specifically, what I started to do more and more and more was teach. Teach residents, teach other people in the community, pediatricians. So all of a sudden, this sort of lifelong pattern of education and of teaching really took shape. I also want to pause and honor what the practice of adult strabismus did for me. First of all, it's not so much what it does for me, but what it does for them. We are the last resort for an adult that has strabismus or amblyopia that hasn't been managed correctly. Then you operate and straight as an arrow, and it just literally changes lives. I started to develop this network of fantastic women colleagues who also had wonderful journeys and stories to tell. There was just a sense that no, your work's not done when the patients go home. And so it was the stature of these people that first got me into different committees, starting first with the American Academy of Ophthalmology. By doing this committee work, sure, takes up a bunch of weekends, but what it also does is it expands your sense of collegiality. Bill Spencer got involved as well. How? Well, he was the executive director for the American Board of Ophthalmology and saw to it that I apply. What I was really learning was how do people go about deciding what it is that an ophthalmologist needs to know in order to practice medicine and take good care of patients. The certification process and the accreditation process of making sure that whether you go to Texas Tech or Robert Wood Johnson or OHSU, you're going to get a fair shot as a resident to come out of it a great ophthalmologist. I decided I wanted to concentrate the remainder of my career in standard setting to make sure that everybody learned how to be the proper physician, regardless of their specialty. This led me to be on the board for the ACGME, the Accreditation Council for Graduate Medical Education, where once again, I learned the value of things like supervision, evaluation, limited duty hours, clinical experience, graduated responsibility, team-based care. All of us need to look at our careers at certain points and try to grow by repotting. And that's what I've done the last 4 years. Pediatric ophthalmology is the cream of the cream everywhere. But it's a delight and an honor and a privilege to do this. The joys of my life really can be summed up as teaching, learning, caring, giving, receiving, growing, surrounding with colleagues. And all of those were my career as a pediatric ophthalmologist and strabismus person. I miss much of the patient care and teaching, but I am so grateful that I have an opportunity to do this.
The Children's Eye Foundation proudly salutes Susan Day as a distinguished member of the Pediatric Ophthalmology and Strabismus Hall of Fame.